last question. Do black men love their children in Harlem?
Of course we do. Oh, no, man, don't be asking. Let me ask a question like that. Let me ask a question like that.
This is Harlem, where you gotta come one day. Harlem, please, let me teach you how to play. This is New York, what's going on? It's crazy. This is Harlem, where you gotta come one day. Harlem, where we struggle every day. This is New York, what's going on? It is crazy.
Streets of Harlem is a research documentary that explores the lived experiences of street-identified black men in multiple neighborhoods across Central Harlem, or Black Harlem. The men share with us a hard truth and a message about how they adapt and demonstrate their resilience to structural violence. They talk about how street life makes sense within the context of intergenerational poverty, unemployment, and poor schooling opportunities. They also speak of how the resilience is grounded in the love of Harlem. They speak of a bond, a connection, a warmth, and a uniqueness to their community. We thank you for joining us, and we now welcome you to the streets of Harlem.
What makes Harlem so special?
Man, listen, ain't no place first, like this here.
You gotta come to Harlem to find a Harlem.
What you trying to do? I mean, what? You wanna play ball? You wanna come down to Kingdom? What you wanna do? You wanna go to 55th? What you wanna do? I mean, everything is special. The people, you can never say you broke in Harlem.
It's the fugitive poverty, man. Blood gang, man. Hats up, man.
You got our own swag.
Yeah, it's wavy. Look, you know, regular day. Stacks up, lightly.
Everybody like to get fresh, tell you fresh, get fresh, because we said it in the 80s, you know what I'm saying? Everybody like to get fly. Harlem is like a fashion statement.
I mean, Harlem, baby. It's the fuck we do, man. Wow, look, it's Harlem never sleep, B. How could you not like Harlem? Look at this shit. We got Rails Lounge around the corner. There's a lot of bars around here. Ain't really no clubs in Harlem except for Zip Code, you know what I'm saying?
A dynamic place. We're alive. It's a very unique experience living in Harlem. There's no place on earth that's like Harlem.
Not just Harlem, New York, Harlem, New York, Harlem, New York. We talk about Harlem in any city. When we talk about Harlem, Harlem is a place, but Harlem is also an attitude.
Everybody wants to come to Harlem. If you come to New York and you didn't go to Harlem, you ain't been to New York.
I'm from Queensbridge. That's the closest part of Queens to Harlem. Harlem is always known for having the best weed. I was coming to Harlem in the 80s when I used to go to Lenox to get the yellow bags. I became a Harlemite. Now Harlem is hood throughout. You ain't gonna find no area that ain't got a project, dog. You have to stick together, and that's what I like about Harlem, man.
Remember, the essence of Harlem is about love. It's always been about love. It's always been about trust, and it's always been about respect.
I love to come to Harlem, especially at this time of the year. It was a whole different culture. It gave you the impression that you were home. It gave me some identification, you know, maybe like I was, you know, looking for, you know, Africa, and I found it in Harlem.
I was really fascinated about Harlem when I read about the civil rights movement from Marcus Garvey, Malcolm X, or President Thomas Sankara, who is a revolutionary, a black freedom fighter who had a historic speech in Harlem. He said, Harlem is our White House.
Et c'est pourquoi j'ai déjà dit et je répète que notre maison blanche se trouve dans le Harlem noir.
That's what I said, and I will repeat myself. My White House is in the Black Harlem.
When a lot of people look at Harlem, they look at Harlem as being like a flagship, particularly New York City, but I would say almost the capital of black people across the globe.
Come on, look at the history, baby. You got Apollo, the old movie theater, Sugar Hill, the Polo Grounds. That used to be where the Giants used to play at. Come on, you got the Rucker.
When you're asking about, like, you know, black men, you know, in Harlem, like, my initial reaction is like, wow, I've just like developed so many great relationships because of the creative energy that's here. The sense of community where, you know, where I came from, like, they call it neighborhoods, but it's not neighborhoods the way it's neighborhoods in Harlem.
I've been walking to church, someone getting shot, keeping it moving. Like, it's not like Harlem and all that it is on a rugged level or on a cultural level. I got all that. So I am Harlem, you know what I'm saying?
I was born in Harlem High School. You can't get no Harlem than that. If you've never been to Harlem, make sure you come through. Just be open-minded and open-hearted. You will get the love in return.
Yeah.
There's no respect. There's no even, I don't even see too much unity like it was before. You got Africans, you got the Jamaicans on this side, you got the Bloods here, the Crips there. It's not like it was before where you could just sit outside all night with your aunts and your uncles and everybody's playing and kids could be out. Now it's like, them kids better be in the house at 10 o'clock.
A lot of shooting, dangerous for the kids. Police killing a lot of people. Kids can't be safe outside no more. It's very dangerous out here now.
If you come in Harlem, that's what people are doing. They just trying to survive any way possible.
It is no difference between uptown and downtown. And once there was tension between uptown and downtown, guys.
Still low tension.
Okay.
Like, as far as, like, when, like, teenagers, they still go through the little, but as far as when you get older, it's not really more tension.
I think downtown Harlem is better. It's a better feeling than uptown. You go uptown, you're feeling safe. Separation is, like, 125th Street.
Right.
And then, like, downtown, it goes to, like, 111th Street, like, Douglas and all that. They consider themselves Harlem, but they're, like, more down, like, 106 and all that. Right. And, like, uptown is, like, up to 155th, a little bit past that. There's no, like, real barriers. It's a grid. Party across the street from St. Nick Projects on 127. We know that we got beef with them, but we, like, we didn't care. It was, like, it was real close to our neighborhood. Me and my friends realized something was wrong, so we decided to leave. We come out, the whole project started pursuing us, walking behind us. A lot, like, 100. More, like, a lot of people. I got a pair of $325 products on my feet. So we started running, and one of them started to come off, and I can't leave that, you know? I can't leave that, it costs too much money.
So when you need something, you're gonna really go for it. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. If you really need money, you're gonna sit out there, you're gonna rob somebody. Whether it could be 5 policemen on the corner of that block, but if you want that man, he just went in that store for that money, you're gonna run up in that store. You know what I'm saying? Everybody gotta go.
I need it to get money because I was in the street by myself. Mm-hmm. Now my mom's pushed me out. She said, you either leave my house, I'm gonna call police on you. It's like, fuck it. I took all my things and I broke out. So my mom's kicked me out. Now I need to get money. You know what I mean? Now I need to get money because now I got all my clothes in the motherfucking van, in my man's van. Mm-hmm. Now I don't got no place to stay. I mean, I'm sleeping in the vans. I need to get this money.
How old were you when you were kicked out?
Whenever I was kicked out?
Yeah.
My first time, 14 years old.
I think one of the main things that lead young black men to the streets is the lack of love in the home, the lack of leadership, and coming from dysfunctional homes, which is single parent homes where the mothers may be on drugs and the fathers may be completely lost and turned out. That brings brothers to the streets. And as a result of that, you got the dog catcher that's out there, which is the police, ready to scoop you up and make a living at your demise. And this is what's happening, you know? They don't provide jobs for us. They don't provide after school tutorial programs for us. They don't provide anything anymore. So therefore, the only other alternative is the streets. which breeds about violence, which breeds drugs, which breeds destruction, which breeds negativity. I mean, it's a whole cycle. They know what's happening. This is not happening by accident.
A lot of guys come up with no fathers. Moms be having 3-4 kids. It's hard. Some guys is forced to take care of their family at 11 to 12 years old by going out and hustling.
When you have nothing, you have to think of ways to get and ways to survive.
I know a few people that had their mother that used drugs and stuff and wasn't taking care of them and had no support, so they just fell into the streets because that's what felt like more like a family thing.
We go to the streets because that's where we get the most love. We get the most respect. We get the most money. It is what it is. You know, my grandparents raised me. I lost both my grandparents. Losing my grandfather was the reason I started wilding. The streets became my family.
You know, it's only so much a mother can do with raising a boy into a man. A kid gets hooked to the street, it's pretty much over. It's like an addiction. It's a rush. You know, I grew up seeing, you know, Rich Porter and Alpo and those type dudes, you know what I'm saying, out here buying kids bikes. So when we growing up, we saw that. You could see Michael Jordan on TV, but we saw the celebrities in the street do stuff like that. So at the end of the day, you see them get the girls, you see them get all the fame, they got the cars. It kind of motivates you to want to do that.
People think, hey, it ain't a lot of black doctors and lawyers, so that means most likely I ain't gonna make it. But I see all these dudes out here, they making money, they driving all these Hummers and all that, and they chilling. They just sitting on the corner doing what they gotta do. So hey, if I do this, I'm gonna have some money, which is wrong. You gotta go to school, make it easier.
If they gave these young people a job and paid them a salary, they wouldn't have all this crime.
Because they don't have money, they stress, they have women in their ear 24/7, bills gotta be paid. You know, it's stressful for both. When you got a woman on your back all the time, talk about we need. So he feel, oh, let me go rob somebody. Oh, let me go sell drugs.
When we say streets, we mean the streets that you do whatever out here that you have to do to make you survive. You know what I'm saying? Just like a person have a job, goes to work every day to survive. His job place is his workplace. You know? Mm-hmm. When you say streets, you know what I'm saying? To be honest with you, you're going to start getting in the streets. You're going to start getting into people selling drugs to provide for their family, to provide for themselves, to buy themselves a pair of boots, to look nice just like the next person. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. To go in the store and buy a soda whenever he thirsty. You know what I'm saying? Every time you go and buy a soda, you got to pay a dollar. You know what I'm saying? If you don't do whatever you got to do to put that money in your pocket, you can't do that. And you can't give your kids a dollar. You know?
I know when I was in the street, though, what kept me in the street was an urgency to pay the bills. Living in New York City, the disparity between the income and the amount of rent you have to pay, price of food and transportation, you got to do something and quit.
We could have done better when we talked about our minimum wage. We know what we started with. The governor started at $8.75 in 2013. We're at $8. Right now, these people are making $290 a week. And at the beginning of 2014, they will be making $320 a week. These families, who at the end of $8 an hour, 40-hour weeks, making $16,000, will not get a check. If they have a child or two children, they won't get a check. We're starting with people making $40,000 and going up to $300,000. And we're leaving a whole segment of the population behind, working poor, who we're supposedly helping.
This day and age, especially with gentrification, it's not necessarily just black men that are doing it. Once one person does it, someone else sees it. They're not working too hard, easy way to make a living.
We stress over the fact that Nick gotta eat.
Hey, yo.
Nobody decides to wake up in the morning as a child and say, yo, man, I wanna hit these streets, I wanna hit this block, but you just forced in that situation.
What you gonna do when your kids is hungry? You know what I'm saying? You gonna let your kids starve? No, you gonna make sure somebody else's kids starve so your kids can eat, you feel me?
It's not a career choice, it's like you are in it.
And if they was to give black men jobs, they wouldn't have to worry about these murder scene, these drug dealers.
I'm so far away in the rain.
you don't know where you are. Creeping down the narrow path of devastation aftermath. And in my sleep, if I should die, oh mama, oh no, don't you cry, 'cause I'll be in a better place. Keep good memories of my face, but while I'm living, I bow my head and pray to live and see another day. And I get on the cloud of lost souls who will just keep blown away.
What about death on the street? How many cats you see lose their lives?
I've seen with my own eyes about 7 people killed. I even had a friend that I was trying to help one time, but he was already gone, you know? But it wasn't really much I could do about it because I'm no technician, no nurse, or nothing like that. You can easily walk up and just sense the tension on certain things, like, you know, like guys that's gonna, something's gonna happen to, or in the future you know it's gonna happen to, because it's like a big chess game. You know who's gonna lose and who's gonna win.
I ain't speaking no bullshit, man. The family circle was broken, man. Everybody need love, man. I never joined a gang because I had wild love in the house. Like, everybody didn't get a lot of love in the house. I really seen somebody pull up and kill off a whole family, my nigga. Like, I never in my life seen somebody shoot a grandmother, a pregnant girl, little kids, teenagers. I never seen somebody just shoot all of them at once. That whole gang shit is for real. Real things came from not getting love.
A lot of people say, oh, I'm a G, I'm a gangster, and don't know what that really means and what consequences you get behind saying that. See, a lot of people are not self-conscious about what the things they say and the things that they get into. Because if you was, then when you come to the streets, you wouldn't complain. Or it wouldn't be a hard life, it'd be the street life.
Go tell your brother that, bitch! Let's get it fucking poppin'! Fuck that, these bitches shot me! No! Let's go!
Who
shot you? I don't run! Touch me!
Some of my friends got jumped real bad. Like, one of my friends got shot before. A lot of people, my brother got shot in town. People dying, a lot of people around here dying, getting shot, getting killed.
How many times have you been jumped?
A few, I don't know, like probably 3 or 4.
Yeah, they call me Shane. I used to have a knife all the time, just carry a knife. Where I was from, you feel what I'm saying? It's real aggressive. I got jumped, I had a lot of fights, I did a lot of stuff to certain people, being in altercation, just fighting as, you know what I mean, regular teenage stuff. So it was a protection thing with me, man.
The summer before, within 3 days, 7 people had gotten shot in, you know, I'd say a 4-block radius from like 127 to 122nd. And that was alarming because I came from a place where it's like, that happens, but it's like, you know, once a month. So 7 times in 3 days, you know, I was coming home from work, caution tape out, sneakers in the road.
Our rate of violent crime, so that's, you know, murder, robbery, rape, etc., is today where it was in the 70s. At the same time, we started to see this drop in crime in New York City starting around 1990, the drop in violent crime. At the same time, our prison and jail populations have also declined. Our state prison population went from a high of like 71,000 in 1999 to 58,000 today.
I was with a friend of mine, and you know, it's like this guy pulled a gun on us. He got us in an uncompromised position. He pulled the gun out, and me and my friend were looking at each other like, man, we could try him. But somebody else came running behind us, and they separated us. Dude grabbed me, put me in the park, took him on the other side, and my friend was tussling with him, and just happened to get up and run. Dude shot at him a few times. And I said, oh, wow, I don't see him no more. I got to get away. And I went to run, got shot, fell. First one hit me, and I didn't even know I was hit. I just collapsed. When I went to run, I just collapsed. The dude picked me up, started grabbing me, like, putting a gun in my face, trying to get me to go in the center of the park. And I'm like, yo, y'all got the money, y'all got the money. So I just pulled out of my t-shirt and ran. And I just threw my hands, just covered, trying to cover my, like my hands was a bulletproof vest, trying to cover my head and back. I just prayed that he ain't hit me nowhere like that. It hit me again in my leg, you know, and I had to hop all the way down the hill. And I just sat there and I was like, wow, couldn't believe this, I got shot. You know what I'm saying? Like, I was totally like naive about what I was doing, and you know, I just learned, like I said, you know, that was a form of chastisement, you know what I'm saying? And it opened my eyes up. It opened my eyes up.
There's a total lack of respect. And I think anybody who doesn't live in a community with us, they see us as different, you know? They come from a community where things are a lot different. So when they come here, it's like, oh, I got to deal with them. And then sometimes, you know, they don't get to know the people. So it's just like doing my job, and then I go home to my neighborhood where I don't have to deal with this. I've been disrespected at times, you know, and I've never been in trouble or arrested, but, you know, they don't care. They look at us all the same. We all get painted with that same brush.
How can you have somebody who wasn't in, live, grown up in this neighborhood or lived in this neighborhood, but you want to protect this neighborhood? It doesn't work out that way. It's going to cause a lot of problems because the cop's going to come up and he don't know how to approach you. He don't know you.
The city is over-policed. There are too many police. They could have continuing education. They need it. You know, this is where the problem is really in education. Like, they don't know who they're dealing with. They don't know how to deal with them. And they haven't really been taught that well. So that's why you have police wilding out.
A lot of profiling going on. They see tattoos, pants, all types of sneakers they want to profile.
The hoodie, jeans, and sneakers, or a fitted baseball cap. I'm the so-called criminal. He must have a gun on him. He check him and see if he has drugs. This is becoming a real police state.
If you're not a part of the police department anywhere, then you are the enemy. And especially in poor neighborhoods where people have to do whatever they have to do.
Where I noticed, like, you know, a lot of negativity is the police, and more specifically, like, the detectives. New York's finest. People that don't have experience in big cities in general, not just New York, don't understand the kind of police state that's going on. Even if you did wrong, once you go to Rikers or you go get into the system and you got that F marked on your forehead, on your chest, everywhere you go, you get shut down for jobs. The way society has that structure built, I see that almost as a crime.
Yeah, the police are tough, but you know the end, you dead. Don't care how many police you kill. And you kill many more, you kill them, send them anymore at your end. You're gonna die. Yeah. I was riding to Jesse Park when they were. Had me a dust blue car. Shot my mother. Two or four days riding down the street, went to the park. They drunk. He got me in the goddamn city park, man. Ain't nobody but me and him. If I got killed, beat up, I'm just a dead nigga. And I said, how you doing, officer? Nigga, all right. I look at him. And I could have said, your mother, man, I'll be a dead nigga. And then I'm there to call me an old half gangster nigga that was gonna push up over here. I'm gonna be a dead nigga. And I'm gonna be a dead nigga. And I wanted to go for that shit. You gonna kill me on no bullshit, you know what I'm saying? But I ain't even had a gun. I might have shot him, got one, but I ain't got nothing. And you find some, they'll bait you in the system. And they kill you. Cause they'll teach you that you don't say nothing. Smart to me.
It's a lot of harassment and police brutality out here, man, that's not even seen or talked about. I done got beat up by the police, you know what I'm saying? Like, that's what happens, you know? And it's like they could get away with it. Yeah, I got my tooth chipped. They chipped my tooth. You know what I mean? Pepper sprayed me, maced me up, and I ain't have nothing on me.
Man, you like Zach Morris, yo.
Cut the street.
Most of the violence I've witnessed and experienced personally in Harlem has been via the police. I'm not saying there aren't dealers. I'm not saying that they're not badasses, idiots, knuckleheads, and such. Of course there are. But I am saying that, like, I don't walk around any part of my community in fear, and really at any point in time.
If we had the number of police officers in my neighborhood in Brooklyn Heights, which is a nice, peaceful neighborhood, largely middle and upper middle class, if we had the amount of police officers that they do in the South Bronx or Harlem, please, we'd see a lot more, I think we'd see a lot more people from my neighborhood getting arrested.
If a cop see you with a female, you much better. But if a cop see you with two males, they're locking you up. How are our kids gonna grow up and look at it, seeing their father getting locked up in front of them or seeing their uncles getting locked up in front of them for no reason? But I guess the judge and them don't see it like that. Everything is a dollar. Everything is a dollar.
Do you think black men in society are respected in general?
By whom? By each other or by the society at large?
By society at large.
No.
Why not?
Because it's dangerous for them to do that. If you give African American male, with his resiliency, his natural inbred resiliency, if you give him any opportunities or signs for confidence building, you are creating a monster.
Go ahead, bro.
Right, and that monster, they know. You know, it's already known that it's too strong.
I went to Graphic Communications Art on 50th Street and Broadway, but I didn't like that school because I never wanted to be a graphic designer and I'd already had a trade.
I recently graduated from DeWitt Clinton High School up in the Bronx. I'm in a school, I'm like the top program, the Einstein program, Macy program. I'm going to college, going upstate to Binghamton University in the SUNY system. I'm probably going to do a science, major in the science and the literature, probably minor in theater. It's a toss-up between pediatric surgery and sports medicine.
I got my GED in jail, you know what I'm saying? I didn't even know how to read when I went to jail, you know?
But I dropped out. That was personal though. Okay. That was like a lot of personal reasons. I was like orphaned, like my mom's had passed when I was young. I went through a lot. That's a personal story. Like, I don't really want to get into that though, but.
I went to St. Mark's, it's on 138th and on Lenox. Very strict, real strict. The rulers, it was like Catholic, you know, that real old, yeah, hit the rulers and all that and send you in the office. But then I went to Cardinal Hayes up in the Bronx too. It was an all boys school. It's a good school, but just me and my character didn't fit well in there, so I got kicked out. I want to take my GED. I got my GED, so.
I went to school a lot of places. I went to school on 144th, 27th and 8th, PS 194. I went to Roberto Clemente on 132nd and Broadway. I went to Wadley on the 114th, between 7th and 8th.
I got kicked out in 12th grade.
In 12th grade, but you obviously graduated.
No, I got a GED after that.
Oh, gotcha.
I got my GED, yeah.
We came from little, proud of him right here. Robert, Trey, we call him. He got his bachelor's degree. He graduated Thursday from City College, right there up the hill in Harlem. Like, love him to death, like, you know.
What you made
and
from,
huh? What you made from? To know where we came from, like, to know what we have done, like, what he done, like, is like, okay, you can't read his book, like,
We used to run the halls, we used to go through the back exits, go get lunch, come back into school, we used to smoke weed in the school, we used to sell weed to our teachers and deans, horrible, horrible.
when I was going to school, they was bringing guns to school. You feel what I'm saying? Guns and knives and sneaking through the back door. So I don't really hear too much of that right now. So a lot of kids are getting their education. I see a lot of younger kids going to college now straight from high school. So that's a good thing. The percentage is up now.
Kids don't get the right education. They feel like, you know, they see people drive by big, nice and fancy cars. They see nice things and they go to what they think, you know, works for them, which is a local drug dealer, or a local hustler, stealer, you know, credit card, whatever.
It's all about a paycheck because most of them don't live in that area. Most of them live in, you know, the suburbs. So basically they come in, like I said, it's all about a paycheck. Get your paycheck, go home, and you don't care what you leave behind.
As a whole, you have to have teachers that care about the people that they're teaching. And a lot of teachers don't live in the area or in the inner city. They travel into the suburbs, and they kind of don't really have a connection to the kids or a connection to the community. And, you know, they see it maybe as a burden. Therefore, the child will get a subpar education.
Cold Blooded Books is our company. From a thug to a man is our first issue.
Definitely something, man, from Harlem to Delaware to Boston, man, that they can relate to, man.
What I do is help students and parents maximize their financial aid opportunities. And what I decided to do is put this philosophy in the book form so it can be attractive and appealing by using the word hustle. And hustle means having the energetic and being forceful in terms of going out there and get it, because if you're lazy, you're not going to get any money. And in the book, it categorizes the number of different sources a student and parents can capitalize off of.
We had over 70% that got accepted to a school, whether that was a CUNY or a private or a SUNY or a whatever. Quite a few of them went off to go to college. To me, that testament is how many of your kids who go to college learned enough to survive and stay there. That's really when you know you're successful.
Right. In most of the schools that I've worked at, there's been a little bit of a fear of black males. I see it start as early as first grade. Teachers afraid of disciplining or handling boys of color, you know. Especially black boys.
One of the things I loved about my old school is that, I mean, there was a serious family atmosphere that was present there. Predominantly black and Latino staff, which matched the student population. I had kids who got in trouble with the law and, you know, was sending them over to the Neighborhood Defenders Association in Harlem, trying to help them get some sort of legal advice when I knew that they couldn't afford to pay for it on their own. I mean, we did everything we could do for them.
It ain't a lot of good jobs out there if you have a criminal past. You feel what I'm saying? Some people get out of there. There's a lot of programs now they producing for young black men, so that's a good thing, but you got to work hard for it. It's not easy.
Nowadays, you know, young people growing up, like, they don't want jobs. They don't want school no more. Like, everybody is in the streets. They want the same thing. They want the money, the holes in the clothes. Like, a lot of criminals got records, can't get a good job, gotta wind up working at McDonald's, and niggas don't wanna work at McDonald's, man. $150 a week, when they probably could make more doing what they do.
Like, if our parents had money, and we had money, we wouldn't do it. Any drug dealer out here, if they got a Wall Street job or a good paying job that they could support their family, they'd stop doing it. Because it's more money doing a legal thing than it is, I mean, it depends on what type of job you're talking about. McDonald's is not paying enough, people have bills. But put us in a condition where we can survive and we can be comfortable, the streets will be gone.
So education, family, those are the solutions to sending more black kids on their way out of Harlem to where they need to go. But I'm saying, once again, you know, Harlem has always had it. Harlem has always had that layer.
When I was in high school, I was working as a messenger. But that was a front to keep my grandma from my back because I was also selling crack at the same time. It's the fast life. It's the money. You get influenced by TV. You get influenced by your friends. You see something that you want, you can't get, you go ask mommy, no, and then you gotta find your means of getting it. And that was my means of getting it. The job was paying, but the fast life was paying better.
My grandfather had a barbershop on 136 for 44 years. He came out every day, no matter what the weather was or whatever the conditions were, he would come to work every day because he knew that what he was doing as a barber was important and that it was appreciated by the community. These services that people need are no longer here. You know, you got Starbucks, you know, you got these little ritzy little restaurants around here, and you know, wineries selling wine that we don't even drink, you know, stuff like that. That's just, you know.
Why when you go on 125th Street right now, you can't find, you could count how many black African Americans work in the working of stores, count how many own them. All right, and count how many work in them. They basically deaded our neighborhood. They deaded our Black Wall Street.
The majority of the, new businesses is coming to Harlem. They're not really trying to take chances with younger black, you know, teenagers. So it's difficult.
People selling sneakers, people selling clothes, people selling their food stamps just to make, to get a dollar a day. You know, people is robbing, people stealing. You gotta do what you gotta do. I mean, I'm not mad at nobody. I don't think, I say it's wrong, but you gotta eat, you gotta survive, you gotta do what you gotta do. I'm not gonna knock your hustle.
For a street dude, 9 times out of 10, he got a felony. Or 3. So a job situation don't look too good for him.
And in order to make it better, the black people gotta step in and take these jobs, not ask for a job, fucking take the job. Because we're willing to work, but some people just don't wanna give us a job because they think we don't wanna work. So I'm glad for Harlem that they're rebuilding it, and then you got the dudes that's stepping up for their brothers and taking these jobs.
Y'all feel your father's love, y'all?
I think my father loves me.
Come on, my father right there on the grill, brother.
Why do folk think that?
Why they folk think what?
The black men aren't into their families,
folks
aren't into their...
Fool.
That's the ignorant
they
folks
fool.
That think that.
They fool.
Y'all think they love the children?
Sure, I think all men love their children. If you ain't got nothing to eat, and you see a guy eating anything like that, you gonna try to take something that'll take you home to your children, some kind of way.
We love our kids. That's it, we love them. I love my kids. I got custody of my kids, you know what I mean?
When you not getting no money or you not financially stable, sometimes that makes you insecure and it make you feel like you can't be the father that you want to be. So that sometimes distance you from your kids too, you know? But of course, man, every man love they kids, man.
Some of their fathers is probably in jail. Some of their fathers is dead. Some of them do have relationships with their fathers, just don't live with their fathers. Like, I don't live with my father, have a relationship with him. Most of my friends, they know who their fathers are, but they see them once in a while, but they don't really know how to have that personal connection with them.
I love my children, but you know, love is an action word, and if you love your children, you do for your children. For many years, I didn't even love myself. You know, and you have to begin to love yourself first before you can even love somebody else, you know? So did I love my children? I felt, it was a feeling that I felt, but what I did was not a demonstration of love.
How would it have been if I wasn't here?
If you wasn't there, it would have been hard. I probably wouldn't have known how to do things. I would have had to learn how to do things.
And where would that have led you?
Let me either locked up or dead somewhere, probably.
That's the whole definition of real to me. Be a brother's keeper. Take care of your family. Be a responsible man. If it comes to you pulling your gun and busting your gun and banging another nigga out, if it's for a cause, if it's for your family, it's for a reason, it's for somebody taking food out your mouth, bang your shit. Bang it to the fullest. If the police come, bang it at them for stopping your cars.
The streets life we live in is crazy. We're losing our fathers and babies every day. Every day. So keep hands touching while our mothers pray. The life we lead will get better every day. Every day.
My father got killed when I was 5.
Yeah, man, my pops died when I was young, too. My household, my grandmoms, just my moms, my pops, everything.
My pops passed when I was young also.
I hear that, bro. Jesus.
You know, for real. It ain't sad, though. It's not sad. Because I know what I want to do as a father. I'm living.
Real talk, man. My pops died when I was 18. That shit hurt. That was my rock.
I'm 28, you know what I mean? Anybody that came up in my time period or my frame, they moms was getting high, somebody in their family was getting high, and we was on the streets to fend for ourselves, you know? So yeah, a lot of people do got the same story, you know?
Do you know your real pops?
My real pops, I've never seen him.
You never seen him, never
I don't even know how he looks.
How you feel about that?
I don't give a fuck.
So if you seen him today, you would hate him, you would love him, what?
be like another dude just walking across the street. All of us, we talk about our household and all that craziness, but you know, we love our family, son.
Definitely.
That's one thing, because I love my moms, you understand what I'm saying?
What made him turn more into the streets was because a year ago, I had relapsed. I was clean for 15 years, and I relapsed. I have no area telling my story. I relapsed. My son had nobody to turn to. He didn't have his mother. He had his aunt, he had his grandmother, but he didn't have his mother who he needed. And he chose the streets. And they gave him that comfort. And that's my fault. So the only thing I can do, I can't make up for what I did back then, but I am doing my damn best right now to make sure he don't get caught up in it.
Unfortunately, it ended up, make a long story short, I ended up coming back, and that's when I was introduced to a substance that was called crack from a family members of mine. And it took my own family to introduced me to it, but it was my choice.
My mother died in 1971, and at that time it was unheard of for the head of household to be an African-American man. And so I see my family and trying to support, really try to pull us apart, saying that my father couldn't raise us, but he fought and he ended up raising all of us.
They don't have a set parental like unit like in the house, or they don't have a full family because of jail or moving or other reasons.
Something that they're socialized to do and socialized to think about from when they're really young is everything around them is kind of pushing that path and pushing them to go that way because that's just how it is and that's how people are.
Uh-oh, it's Uncle Tom. It's Uncle Tito. She opening them eyes?
A little bit.
That's as much as they open. Now they open still.
It's the light.
Splish splash, I was taking the bath. All up on a Saturday night. Ooh, that girl had her first bath.
The two sisters.
Streets, every time I fall, I get back on my feet. Started from nothing, ended up with something. Started from nothing, ended up with something. I don't know it all, but I do know the streets. Every time I fall, I get back on my feet. Started from nothing, ended up with something. Yeah, started from nothing, ended up with something. Forgive me, I gotta feed my kids. I know it's a lot of foul shit a nigga did. They say if I keep it up, I'ma do a bid. I'll be dead in the dirt. It is what it is. Put my life on the line, make sure my kids fine. Whether 9 to 5 or life a crime. Cause I'll be damned if they can't eat dinner. We'll have a winter coat and it's cold as December. I go out and roll before I let them starve. I pray to God I don't get stopped by cop cars. Trunk full of work and a beat up poopy. Feeling the same way with Big Ro Juicy. It was all a dream and it's so true. But where I'm from, even dreams don't come true. I live in reality. Mama said she mad at me. Call my first felony. Oh, what a tragedy. I don't know it all, but I do know the streets. Every time I fall, I get back on my feet. Started from nothing, ended up with something.
Been to Rikers, both at the MDC, the Manhattan Detention Center. I've been to C-76, been to the 4 building, I've been to the 3 building. I also did 2 years upstate at Fishkill Correctional Facility. It was beneficial in a way because it rescued me from the streets. So I was using, getting high, I wasn't trying to help myself. You're clean, you're clear, you can reflect on what you've done, and there's always a question, you know, are you gonna return to that lifestyle, knowing the consequences, or are you going to seek a positive alternative and lead a productive, you know, wholesome type of lifestyle?
You have a lot of low-level offenders. Mm. You know, petty drug sales, petty drug possession. I mean, we have criminalized so many activities in this country, contributed to this booming prison population, which is now bankrupting our states. We can't afford the prison system we built up.
They'll teach you how to make fucking license plates. They'll teach you how to drive a truck. They'll teach you how to drive a school bus. They'll teach you how to motherfucking cut wood and do shit that's manual labor. But they won't teach you technology. They won't teach you computers. They don't have computers in jail like that. Modern day slavery. They want us to do manual labor. They don't want us to sit back and punch buttons. They want manual labor, so that's all they're gonna teach us.
I done get in the system about 8 years of my life. I done did 2 state bids.
What was that experience like to beat the body?
To beat the body, it was a extra weight off my shoulders. I never knew the person. Dude ended up coming around, and somehow he got killed. It's been 9 years dealing with this body for somebody I don't know. Having it dismissed helped me come home to my freedom. I just hope that his family could move on, which I believe they have since it's been so long.
My son was very intelligent. I'm not saying call him a son. He could read good, he could think good. He could be anything he wanted to be. He chose to be there. And I seen it. I couldn't tell him. I would have told him, but he wouldn't have listened anyway. He wish he would have took the right path. Now he seen me struggle. I worked hard, me and my wife. And we had a lot of disappointment in trying to make up enough finance. And I know that affected him. That he had the discipline enough to understand that if he went to college and went all this and waited and let things come to him slowly, they don't think that on a level. I left home when I was 14 years old, 13 years old. So I understand how to go.
Frequent flyers are the people who the jail administrators would refer to as those individuals who would end up on Rikers about 4 or 5 times a year. These are typically very drug addicted individuals who really had no place to go when they got out, and so basically were released to the streets, would pick up within minutes, and as soon as they could get some kind of drugs in their system, you know, after whatever, at some point, addiction will demand criminality. And then they were back on Rikers. You know, they got their old job back on Rikers. They were welcomed. In many ways, what we see is our jails certainly have become, you know, our social institutions, providing some very basic necessities that people don't get in their communities. Three meals a day, medical care, a job. This is a society about retribution, where people continue to pay and pay and pay, regardless of whether they've done their time.
You know, Whitey don't forget nothing. I'm gonna keep it real with you. He has a record of everything, and he will definitely pull it out on you when necessary to let you know why you don't qualify for this job, because you had 2 previous felonies. And everybody needs a second chance. Some of us need 3rd and 4th chances. Some of us need 5th and 6th chances, but we all need a chance.
My name is Ron Shula. This photo here, back in the 90s, Fortune purchased this building, which was an old church. And they renovated it and made it into transitional housing for convicted felons who are coming home from state penitentiaries.
Fortune's a place where we look at changing both the criminal justice system through our advocacy and providing the vehicles for people to build new lives and build lives that are sustainable and contribute to community health. And we do that by believing in the people who walk through our doors. And so our services are shaped by the voices and contributions of formerly incarcerated people. About 70% of our staff are either formerly incarcerated or in recovery. So we have services that range from walk-in services, which is crisis intervention. Okay. Anybody can just walk in as long as they have a criminal justice background, meet with a counselor, get referred to services, and get their crisis met. We have more deeper end services that include employment services, which is soft skills training, job placement, job retention. We have family services, alternatives to incarceration, licensed outpatient drug treatment. We have congregate housing, scatter site housing, health services. And so we have a host of services that really help people when they come here to stabilize, including education, everything from literacy through GED. We see about 3,000 people a year, and we have about 175 staff.
My experience with the penal institution was 6 months in jail, C-74, 1976.
What was it like in C-74 on Rikers Island in 76?
What it was for me was enough not to go back. I didn't have to go for no my master's degree in the penal. That was enough for me. You know, not to say I grew up an angel after that, but it was enough for me to say I did not want to go back.
Incarceration of someone, whether it's African-Americans, Caucasian, Chinese, is a big business.
To my boy Javal Nesmith Jones, I love you, my nigga. I love you to death, my nigga. Ain't nothing I won't do for you. I can't wait till you get home, because I ain't the same without you.
Real nigga to real nigga.
Right? Mm-hmm. Who knows Charles Rangel? Who knows these guys? Some of them I can't even name, because you don't see them until election time come. You know, even with the school board, you don't see these people.
You have your politicians, reverends, imams, your teachers that are sincere. There are, you know, a number of politicians out there who are looking to use the community for their own selfish ends. Is it the majority? You got to look at the evidence. You got to look at Harlem. You got to look at the products. You got to look at the people. You got to look at, you know, the streets.
The school where I used to work in Harlem is very much supported by Inez Dickens and Bill Perkins. They are some of the reasons why that school has stayed open as long as it has, and it hasn't been turned into condos, or the school hasn't been taken over by charter school. The school is actually staying open, and it has been a place where a lot of black boys and black young men have been taken in and done pretty well. But at the same time, you're talking about two politicians that voted for the rezoning plan of 125th Street that is kicking black businesses out, you know, kicking, is a part of kicking black people out of Harlem.
I think Al Sharpton has done a lot, you know, and I still think he's become, you know, a decent voice for the black community. And I always like what he, you know, he's bringing to the table, even though he's gotten a bad rap over the years.
To me, Sharpton is one of the greatest guys in the world, man. If you need him, he, what else can you say about him?
Yo, I'm from Lenox. That's why Sharpton building right there. It's that National Action Network.
Yeah, that's for sure. Most of the people in this neighborhood don't even go
to the meetings at 55 West to know what's going on and stuff like that. That's why people get surprised when they see Magic Johnson Theater built or the Hilton that's going to be built on Park Avenue.
Barack Obama's in office. That changed that night in November, you know, when everybody was going out to Adam Clayton Powell. To me, that was a change. Like, I'd never seen so many people so happy to be together at one point without any, you know, nothing going on. So I felt like that was a change.
It takes somebody from here to change here. I'm going to keep it real with you. Somebody who grew up rich and think they going to just try to change this, it's not going to fucking happen. It just ain't.
I don't know too much about Charlie Ring. That's Sam Nandin. He's at the occasions and, you know, and speaking and this and that. I don't know what he's done, you know, for the Harlem community.
When Charlie Rangel first got elected, I felt he was doing something, him, CC, Virginia Fields. But nowadays, I think it's all about the dollar and bettering yourself, not bettering your community, bettering yourself, getting yourself a better title.
Why wait till something happen before you show up on the news and speak for us? It should have been happening. It shouldn't wait till somebody gets killed or stabbed or something bad happen or something good happen. They should be out there every day.
I don't want to pat our era on the back, but I have to. This seems where most of the strength from our leaders came from. And I'm not only talking about males, I'm talking about females too. Until they can get it together amongst themselves, then they're not going to get it together amongst themselves. I'm only as strong as my leadership.
I don't think they're doing that much of a good job. They could do better.
They can do but so much.
Yeah,
they gotta take care of their families too. That's how I see it.
That's how I see it too, bro.
Could they do more?
They try.
I can do more. I know it start with me. If they can help me a little more, then I know I'ma help them do my part. That's what it's about. I'm not blaming nobody. Everybody blame the system, can't blame the system. I gotta do my part.
There's some people that are really out for the community and trying to help, but then some people, it's just politics, you know?
In the Congress, we'll be working to make certain that our schools get better and that the jobs come to our community. We're talking about jobs and we're talking about jobs now. This certificate of special recognition is presented to you with the gratitude of all your fellow citizens.
Thank you on behalf of a grateful community for bringing this, because every block needs a Kamali Williams.
I just want to say thank you for having this great block party. It's an honor and privilege to represent you. And please, I know Charlie Rangel and Inez Diggins were here earlier, but please don't forget to vote.
In closing, Harlem, I leave you with a message that I hope inspires you to wisely and strategically fight, and fight harder than you ever have fought before. Keep in mind, if you're not fighting for yourself, if you're not fighting for the brother next to you, then at least fight for your children.
I've seen these guys for years and years and years. Do they really ever get anything done? I don't think so. But at the same time, the community does need leadership. It needs to be activated. It needs at times for someone to step up and say something that makes sense and at least is born from the sensibility of the people here. And those cats have made their life out of doing that. I'm not mad at them. I like to see people's activism be less TV and more like actually have the hands-on, having people pop out on the other side with skills and perspectives that can enable them to do stuff.
They know what's happening. Mm-hmm. This is not happening by accident. You know what I mean? Our politicians know what's going on, but they don't give a fuck. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? They already sold us out a long time ago.
How do we do it differently so that we bring in more people into the conversation, so that more people feel ownership of the system?
It's just a front for them to make themselves look good in front of their peers. If you sit around and wait for a politician or a senator like that, you've been waiting all your life. Black men caught up in the criminal justice system, and definitely out here in Harlem. Do they actually believe in God?
I think that
is their faith genuine.
I think that their faith is genuine, but I think that we have to present God to them in a way where they can believe in God. For too many years, we have had the very passive Jesus, okay, with the very pale skin, the blue eyes, who's been very accommodating. But when you really teach people who Jesus was, who Jesus is, an individual who was revolutionary, an individual who looks like many of the people that are out here today, people, when they're able to relate to Jesus and know that they are made in the Imago Dei, the image of God, then that Jesus becomes believable for them. And so I think the God that we've been presenting people with, the Jesus that we've been presenting people with, has not been the Jesus and the God that really is biblical, okay, or that is really someone that they can relate to. It's important that you can relate to what you believe in. If you cannot relate to it, you're not going to believe in it.
Yes. I think God gives us that basic sense of recognition. I think he built that into us. I think it's in our DNA. I think as a black man, we have a strong spiritual tradition. In Africa, a lot of the celebrations and traditions all point to something higher and greater and more spiritual. And I think through the institution of slavery, I think we use those traditions, customs, rituals, and ideas to help us survive, to help us cope with racism, to help us cope with the injustices that have been placed against us.
I take God with me everywhere. You know, I couldn't take him in those parties. God was carrying me when I was there, little did I know. Because for me to be here today is only by God's grace. So these were all Greek and Jewish, Russian synagogues.
Wow.
We have a lot of them scattered throughout Harlem that today are either Catholic churches or Baptist churches.
I try to live righteously, but like out here in the streets is like hard and everything is tempting around me.
Yeah.
Most people in my church are really successful. I get to see a different aspect of life. It makes me that much more well-rounded.
Why is God important?
Almighty is God. Like, I believe there's a heaven and there's a hell, and that one day God's gonna come back. You're either gonna go one place or the other.
It's God and love. And I got it all on.
He showed you. He let you know that's wrong. He yell to tell you, man, what's gonna happen. He tells you. Some people don't think about it, but you better listen. And then he tell you this, well, what your son gonna do, what that one gonna do.
I've worked with hundreds of offenders in the system and on the streets. They self-identify as religious. They can name a religious institution that they attend in the community. And in the prisons and jails, you do see a very high level of religious activity. There is a lot of worship in our prisons and jails because people find themselves at a point in life where they are praying for salvation. They're also off of drugs. I do feel that most of what is referred to as jailhouse conversions. I think the motivation from which it stems is genuine. But there's a real, I think too, also a real sense of fate. If God wanted it to be a certain way, it would happen. And I don't find that they have a nihilistic outlook at all, quite the opposite.
As a Leo, as a lion, we strong individuals. Lions have no fear. I fear nothing but God.
Said it's good to die young. Guess I'ma live old. Sorry, mama, but your little boy grown. Hope the judge see past the drugs that I sold. It's like I've been down this road, asking God to forgive me for my shallow soul. Some say I'm heartless and my smile is cool. 45 and choppers, what I call crowd control. Trying to get rich, take trips around the globe. High presidential suites like 1,000 floors. Stepping on stage with 1,000 flows. First week, 500,000 gold. But I'm still waiting on my spaceship. Only God know how long I could take this. Roaches in the kitchen coming home from the grave shit. Looking at my check and a nigga ain't make shit. Might sew behind a damn fridge. Got my kids getting to make a sandwich. Make a meal off the music, that's what the plan is. Fuck underground, trying to land on the canvas. They said I ain't living right, cause a nigga still dealing white. Don't worry about mine's gonna get a life. How can something so wrong feel so right? And it feels so nice. They say someday we all gonna pay a price. So every night I talk to Christ. Hope his footprints is there as I walk through life.
My grandmother had 13 kids shopping for levers all the time. He give us a discount. He know she ain't hustling, she's struggling. So she coming by 13 coats. He look out, that street love.
The reason why I give to people is because I've taken from people. When I was young, I used to take. wasn't about giving, it's about getting. So now that I'm older, I'm giving.
You look at the history of Harlem, Bumpy did it, Nicky did it, Guy did it, Frank did it. That's why when the cops came after them, it was hard because the community had their back, because they was giving back to the community.
I know one guy right now, his birthday is today, but he's having a cookout for the kids.
Nice, nice, nice.
So
nice.
That shows you, and he's been like that all his life. So it's coming from his heart.
It's very much genuine because it shows that at least somebody cares. It is showing that at least somebody's doing something to make something better for the community.
We give love, you know, we give block parties, you know, 2-3 times every summer. We give basketball tournaments, we participate with friends, you know what I'm saying, our blocks, you know what I'm saying, get other blocks, you know what I'm saying, and basketball games, you know what I'm saying, we go, you know, on little trips, our kids, you know, neighboring kids, on, you know, on a little summer trip, you know, every summer. Street love basically is, you know what I'm saying, we got love for each other, you know what I'm saying, everybody look out for each other, you know what I'm saying, everybody will last a lot longer.
I mean, when I'm not here, people collect my meals for me. It's like a family. But it takes some time. When it just comes, no one will say anything to you. But over time, how you live, how you relate to them, then you become an insider. It took me about 3 years before I could become an insider, meaning where they embrace me, where they say hi to me and so on.
Every year, you know, you have the Harlem Day events, you have vendors out, the floats, parades, hip-hop artists, and they do their thing, motivational speakers. You know, you have a variety of events.
Kingdom is a basketball tournament, a fourth of projects. Every summer now, it's getting more popular and more popular. I don't know, it's starting to outshine in the ruck uptown. People just go there, it's like a big fashion show. It's like a social gathering. Initially, there's no violence, but like I think like when like the cops move, people start drinking, smoking. At the end of the night, it's gonna be something.
It shows unity, a little bit of unity. It brings everybody together. Even though you might do the barbecues and stuff like that, you might be around somebody that you really don't like, but it brings y'all together for that moment, so it feel good, it's a good vibe.
Yo, what's good? Shen Shizzy, what's good, brother?
You already know, my little man B-Day.
Hey, what's
right
up, now?
Lennox?
How old is he?
1 year old, man.
For sure, guys.
Y'all need me out here, family and friends, B.
You talking about?
Yeah, man.
So what's up, boy?
I'm sorry, I don't really only talk to guys like they talk to ladies.
No, ladies.
It's a block party.
It's a block. What's
the block party?
14th Street, man.
14th Street.
One for the fam, one for the block, one for the hood. You feel me?
Back when I was coming up, our street used to stay closed every day in the summertime. For real, they used to have the sprinklers running, right. People playing hopscotch, roadies. They had basketball courts in the street.
Right.
You know, it ain't like it used to be.
People who getting money, if they giving back to the community, it just so the motherfuckers don't call the police on their ass, you know? So it's give and take. I'm gonna do what I could do for the community, but at the same time, I need the community on my side.
I know a couple of drug dealers that gave to us, you know, blocked the street, gave us bikes, gave us school books, book bags, clothes, money. If you're gonna be in the community and you're gonna be selling drugs, you should do stuff for the kids in your block.
Some people get paid on this block. Do they give back to the community?
No. They take their little bit of change. They don't try to buy no grocery store. They don't try to open a laundromat, little game room.
It may be legal or illegal. They do a lot for their community.
Like, all me and all my friends all was in the game room, and this times when we ain't have money, and maybe a hustler came in, he gave us quarters, or one of our family members came and gave me and all my friends money to play the games because they ain't want nobody doing no dumb shit that they didn't have to be doing. Maybe if I give him these quarters this day, it might stray him away from what he was going to do or what he might have got into.
We'll be right back.
ever since I was growing up, you know, teenager, I had a fascination with chess, and it was the older guys that, you know, pulled my coat and taught me the, you know, the rules in the game and the strategies and the tactics and different openings, and, you know, it's just a, you know, especially now, it's summertime, you know, and it's beautiful, and what a healthy way to spend your time, you know, but in the park, you know, playing chess. You got the hustlers, cats want to, you know, gamble, and then you got the cats that, you know what I mean, they talk a good game. They'll talk you, you could be winning the game, but they'll keep talking to you, and, you know, they'll be written space in your head, and before you know it, you know, you lost the game. And you got the quiet assassins, you know, they don't say much, you know what I mean, but they, you know, win and win, you know what I'm saying, they just, you know, they just play good chess. You know, you'll have grandmasters, masters, that'll come from downtown and shoot the Harlem, you know, because they've heard of, you know what I'm saying, the legends that, you know, and they'll play, you know, they'll play the, you know, they'll play the street masters out here. Vice versa, go down and play, you know what I mean, and downtown to 14th or Union Square, Washington Square, and, you know, and just represent, you know, represent Harlem.
Nah, not from here. We ain't from the CIA. Not today, brother.
Gentrification, I believe, is never a good thing. If a white wants to move into Harlem, that's your choice. I can't say for a white person, for any other person, you know, don't move in Harlem. You know, as blacks, I think we need to, you know, stay with our roots, stay with ourselves, stay with our families, stay with our communities.
They have already made up in their minds that they don't want us here, and they're gonna do whatever they possibly can to get us out of here. Every time that they send a tour bus through this community to watch us as though we are specimens, because I used to drive for them. And I used to listen to some of the disparaging things that they say.
I used to walk through this block, you wouldn't see none but blacks. Now you see Puerto Ricans, whites, and Mexicans, and all other nationalities. I think it's a good thing, yeah.
I remember when they were raffling off brownstones from like 1974 to about 1979 in the Harlem for a dollar.
Different class of people moving in. Like, people say it's because it's white people moving in. It's not a racial thing to me. I think it's a money thing. So when the land is more valuable, then the police is going to police it a different way.
All these white people coming in, they buying up everything, you feel me? Like, rent getting higher. And it ain't really no more money right now. Like, this shit is slow.
This trend, you know, for other people to come over and assimilate our community, it's only gonna go so far. There's gonna come a point when we're gonna say enough is enough. Groups of people, you know, walking around that's not indigenous, you know, that don't look like us, they don't sound like us.
You gotta welcome change, you know what I mean? And just accept it and figure out a way to try to embrace it, you know what I mean? Yeah. Change, you know what I'm saying?
You got condos over here, money. You gotta build the condos across the street from the projects. How real is that?
Got million-dollar condos on Fifth Ave going up right now.
All these brownstones they built up, they were all like vacant lots, you know what I'm saying, when I was growing up.
And people taking these large lots of burnt out whatever and flipping that into a condo, whatever. Now you have a mix between what was Harlem and what Harlem will be. Small businesses in Harlem have probably suffered the most. Black-owned, perhaps, businesses, but maybe not black-owned buildings. That storefront that you remember seeing, whatever, yeah, black name, black brand, but it's still a Jewish person that's owned it for all of these years.
Since white folks moved in, I ain't protesting nothing, but since they moved in, like, now we can't sit in front of our building because they're nervous.
first reactions are, why would you move there? Are you crazy? You're white, you're wrong. Come check me, 125th and Lennox, it's all cool.
We get harassed more because of them. There ain't nothing happened to near white folk since they moved in Harlem.
We're not prejudiced, B. I mean, long as they don't act no way, we don't act no way. You know what I'm saying? I speak, you speak back, B. It's all about respect. You ain't gonna speak, then you deserve to get smacked, and that's the type of shit that happens.
Don't be looking down at us, you moving in our neighborhood.
I was actually jumped one time walking back home, and I think that to anybody who would be walking home, that would be a scary experience. So why am I going to let something crappy that happened to me dictate what I'm gonna do for the rest of my life?
I moved to the Bronx because I was gentrified out of Harlem, a place that I had called home for a very long time. I am somewhat hopeful that Black Harlem now is going to be able to provide economic development opportunities that were not here for my generation.
Some of the people that I grew up with in Harlem, they're not here. Mm. Everybody, even the Black faces, are strangers. Mm. They're from Brooklyn. Mm. They're from Queens. They're from Long Island. Yeah. They're from Connecticut. They're from Delaware. You understand? When they come, we don't know that. You've been here the last 5 years? You know, you're a Harlemite now?
White people is moving into Harlem and all that. Like, it kind of make it a little better in the sense that now that we can interact with them and see that they ain't no different from us, like, we all the same.
Oh, hold up. Give me a fucking hug. She Swiss raised Chris. Walls. We was on tour together.
She raised walls with Chris. We got 15 years of better in this, doing this loud, real, NYC to the whole globe. England, Japan, projects, gutters, jails, all that. Get that music in your mind and stop that ignorance.
People is a federal offense. Irregular but never irrelevant. Swiss Chris, get your fucking head right, yo. Yeah, I'm out. See raised walls. I'ma keep pushing. Word to Bronx.
Influx of all colors, of people from all nationalities, but I think there will still be a Black Harlem.
Black Harlem right now is almost great. I see in the future Harlem becoming even more diverse, becoming more of a mecca for people to come and showcase their talents, to start a family, to create businesses, and just foster growth.
Harlem, 5 years from now, it's not going to be a bunch of drug corners. It's not. Drugs ain't going nowhere, but you won't see 30 dudes on the corner like you see now. It's not going to happen.
I hope there is no future for the men in the streets of Harlem. I hope to be their day when you see brothers walking through Harlem, brothers working in Harlem.
So we can be whatever we want to be. And there's plenty of young Black kids that's doing right, too, that's going to school, that's getting what they need to get out of life and want more.
Life is what you make it. If you want to be miserable, you're going to be miserable. If you want to be happy, you're going to be happy.
as a young man, you just gotta focus and figure out what's gonna work for you. When I mean work for you, what's gonna work for you that year and 5 years later? And I think that's important for the youth to know, like, what's gonna work for me 5 years from now? Because at the end of the day, the streets ain't got no sick days.
All the young brothers out here like me that's going through this struggle, man, like, you know, don't always worry about the things you don't got, you know what I'm saying? Be grateful for some of the shit you do got.
We don't need no more of our black brothers, our black sisters locked down in jail up north. We need everybody out here being a family right now.
We all stick together, we'll be right here 15 years from now, you know what I'm saying? Or probably somewhere better, or hoping the community better, you feel me? Doing something, you know what I'm saying, for the little ones.
All the laws gotta change. This land is full of laws that just gear to a certain class of people.
There's a lot of white people that's gonna go through the same shit that we go through, you know what I mean? So it's gonna be, ain't about black or white, it's about rich or poor, you know what I'm saying? So that's how it's gonna be. The rich niggas gonna survive, poor niggas gonna die off.
Revolution is coming, man. I mean, you know, it's almost here, man. It's
Obama.
For one, Obama. And, you know, things just developing throughout. We in 2011, 2012, 2013, things are happening, man. You know, a revolution is coming. Y'all be ready, and it will be televised.
For sure.
Were you ever shot again?
Yeah, I was shot after that again.
Okay.
Actually, this one happened like New Year's Eve going into New Year's. Now, I should have been home with my wife bringing in New Year's, you know what I'm saying? But I told her I'm gonna hang out with the fellas. Bar right up there on Lace Avenue called Bonitas. We in there having a ball, you know what I'm saying? Pop a bottle, poop, 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 you know what I'm saying? And a friend of mine's, man, you know, his temper was so crazy, he got into something with some dudes and a whole lot of commotion started taking place and guns start being drawn. And we goes outside and I'm telling him, yo, what is you doing, man? What is you doing? The people came out shooting at him. Bang, 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 bang. All of them bullets, they must have shot like 6 times, 7 times. You know, none of the bullets hit him, one of them hit me. I'm like, wow. And I didn't even know I was hit, I just felt something. Like a feeling going through my leg. I'm like, oh, sweat, I'm shot. Oh man, the lesson is to stop putting yourself in environments where you can be hurt at or harmed at. You know what I'm saying? You know, listen to what people are saying to you when they're saying it. Most importantly, listen to people. You know, even if you don't want to hear it, listen. You know, something might spark in your head.
And the one thing I want to say is do the right thing.
I hear that.
Do the right thing, you go a long way. That's right. All I can tell any person, black or white, red or green. Try to live right and do the right thing, respect people, and you go for it.
Right, right.
And you'll be successful in America because the opportunity is here. It's up to you to take advantage of it.
Right.
We got to work hard for it. Got to work hard for anything you want in life. Good. But you have a better chance here.
Yeah.
In the place that's in the world.
Cause my mama always taught me this. She always said this. Put something back for the rainy day. We never had nothing but we were taught. So if you had, you save. You save, man. You take care of certain things. You owe that to yourself. If you don't do it, you can't teach your kid nothing. You might say, I love you. You know, I talk to you. And I show you all that philosophy, theory shit. But something comes to be real.
For people like me, it's too late. It's over. From now on, the younger people who's having these children have to be re-educated, and then they have to teach it to their children.
Make it real for them. Like, why do I need to know this? Why is it relevant for me? Because at the end of the day, it's like, okay, that's what you do in college, but a lot of times the boys don't even believe that they're gonna get to college. So what can I do at this point that's gonna make you a better person if you don't even make it to 21?
I also went to a prep school. I went to a school around a lot of white kids. I actually teach at the school that I went to. But that didn't mean that I didn't come back to where my people are. Just because I went to school on 85th between Park and Lex didn't mean that I abandoned the Bronx, and I abandoned Harlem, and I abandoned the people that look like me. It's about making sure that you keep a grounded mental state and a level head and not turning your back on those who look like you.
Fathers, that gang thing, they got a whole lot of graveyards waiting for you, and they got a whole lot of jails waiting for you. And you're gonna break a lot of parents' hearts, man, you know what I'm saying? Representing nothing, because in the end result, something you're gonna get is a mirror on the wall or somebody burning candles for you, you know what I'm saying? Or visiting your grave site. There ain't nothing good could come out that. If you doing 25 life in jail, ain't nothing you could do for your seed or nothing you could do for your children, you know what I'm saying? And it's so hard, though, because, you know, it's hard to penetrate people's minds and get them to focus on what's positive, man. The only thing I can say to you, man, is gangs is, and the way they going now is going to ultimately be the death of you, man. That's it.
Children's bike for not being law-abiding enough about riding on sidewalks. This institutionalized bigotry.
I heard on the news today they're taking us out of our zone, our heritage, our home. We're nomads just roaming. It's never been the same since. 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 Yeah, yeah.